guitar arrangement on the end of it. That seemed to really pick up, and like the song goes, like Free Bird, you know, right at the end of the lyric, it's like, I want to fly high like a free bird, and then the guitar starts soaring. There's something about, you know, playing in front of 50,000 people and seeing them still get up for that song, seeing them stand up, and just seeing the people get up and put their hands together for a song that you wrote. To me, that's what it's all about. That's what makes me keep going back. The lyric content of Free Bird is based on the idea of, you know, everybody being free. To me, there's nothing freer than a bird, you know, just flying wherever it wants to go. And that's what this country is all about, you know, being free. And I think everybody wants to be a free bird.
She won this contest that we met him, seems like years ago, but it's just been a few months, and he's came to a lot, and he's just a big inspiration and a little fan and stuff, and we love him, and I don't know, I feel like I know him all my life, but he's cool, and you better like him too, or he'll kill you, he's so big. It up last night. I didn't have nothing to do.
Tell me about like a sense of family. Do you get a sense of family when fans are so dedicated like Joe?
Yeah, man, that's why we're here, for the people, as long as we can make them happy, and for 2 hours every night they can forget about their troubles and cares and house payments and their girlfriend broke up with them. Then we'll play, and it's just our honor. Gifts, so we want to share it. But people like Joe's why, and anybody.
Yeah, Joe was saying to me that he comes out to a lot of the shows because he feels the band's given him so much that he's giving back. What kind of sense do you get from that support, that diehard support?
Well, we haven't given nothing but music. You know, that's all we know how to do is play. Stuff from old lawns or pick strawberries. Thinking of doing that, there's a lot of money in that, but it's just like I said, I just repeat myself, it's for the people, that's why we're here, because we hate each other, no, it's just, we just want to get what we got, you know, get to.
Friends, a look at Lynyrd Skynyrd, a Channel 4 Eyewitness News special report with Tom Wills. Ladies and gentlemen, Lynyrd Skynyrd.
Hello, I'm Tom Wills. Lynyrd Skynyrd's home, of course, was Inco Springs.
The land really meant something. They rehearsed in a little makeshift cabin out in Green Cove Springs near a creek. It was hotter than Hades out there, and they called the studio, which was just a little tin cabin. They called it Hell House.
Sharon Lawrence is the author of a book called So You Want to Be a Rock and Roll Star, featuring Lynyrd Skynyrd. She has known the boy since 1973.
Gary and Alan are a little younger than Ronnie, and they all played baseball together. And one day, Gary and Alan said to Ronnie, we think we're going to have a rock band. And instead of laughing, Ronnie said, yes, we are. You're going to play guitars, and I will be the leader.
Ronnie Van Zant, Gary Rossington, and Alan Collins did form a band. They called themselves 1%. And the circuit in those days meant things like high school dances.
They were playing local clubs and local concerts. I can remember them back in 66 and 67 when they were the 1% and everything. They just really wanted to play bad all the time.
Van Zant was lead singer. Rossington and Collins were guitarists. Along the way, they added fellow Floridians Leon Wilkerson, who played bass, and Billy Powell, who played keyboards. Those five, plus guitarist Ed King and drummer Bob Burns, formed the original Lynyrd Skynyrd. One of the band's first records was cut in 1970 at a small local studio. They named it Need All My Friends.
First contact I actually had with their group, I received a call and they asked to permission to use a picture of my real estate sign on their album cover. And I said, fine, go ahead. And then the second contact I had with them, they came to a concert here in the Coliseum and they asked me if I would introduce them, and I agreed to that.
In the late 1960s, Lynyrd Skynyrd was a phys ed teacher here at Lee High School. This is where he first met Ronnie Van Zant.
Students had to wear socks. They had to have their shirt tails in. They had to wear belts. Sideburns couldn't be below the ears. The back of the hair couldn't touch the collar. And we were asked by the administration to enforce these rules and send people who didn't conform to those rules to the office. Unfortunately, or fortunately, whichever the case may be, one of the ones I sent down was in a band. And certainly at that time, if you'd have called out their name, no way I would have known them. And even later on, if they'd have walked up to me, I wouldn't have known them.
But Van Zant remembered Lynyrd Skynyrd well enough to make his name famous with a slightly different spelling. It was also here at Lee High School that the group gained something of a reputation as hard-living hellraisers and roughnecks. And it was a reputation that stayed with them on stage, in print, and in their music.
Was highly exaggerated. And of course, when Ronnie would write a song called Whiskey Rock and Roller, people would immediately seize on that instead of the one called, A Searching or Ballad of a Simple Man. They were signed to a musician who'd started his own label, and he said, gee, there's such colorful characters, I want to build this hard living image up. So when I first met them, I expected to see the Hell's Angels. I mean, I was shaking, And I found, babies. Their idea of a big time was for eight of them to share one bottle of scotch over 2 days.
Lake Charles, Louisiana. Shreveport, Louisiana. Dallas, Texas. Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Houston, Texas. Austin, Texas. Like many rock groups, Lynyrd Skynyrd had its share of changing faces. Ed King and Bob Burns left. Artemus Pyle took over on drums. Steve Gaines joined as a fourth guitarist. And three backup singers were added, Leslie Hawkins, Cassie Gaines, and Joe Billingsley. These five joined Van Zant, Rossington, Collins, Powell, and Wilkerson in a band that achieved international fame.
To WMJS Radio, the Federal Aviation Administration reports that a plane carrying 25 persons crashed tonight in southwest Mississippi. Among those aboard, the Lynyrd Skynyrd Rock Group. An FAA spokesman says he received a report of multiple fatalities and some survivors in the crash of the Convair 240. He said the plane was en route from Greenville, South Carolina to Baton Rouge, Louisiana, when it crashed 2 miles northeast of Gillsburg, Mississippi. He said police and a rescue squad are on the scene. That's a plane carrying 25 persons crashed tonight in southwest Mississippi. Among those aboard, the Lynyrd Skynyrd Rock Group. An FAA spokesman says he received a report of multiple fatalities and some survivors. We'll try to have more for you at 10.
Thursday, October 20th, a twin-engine Convair 240 with the name Lynyrd Skynyrd painted on the side is 580 miles out of Greenville, South Carolina, bound for Baton Rouge. The 24 passengers aboard are heading for a concert date Friday night. They're relaxing. Some are playing poker.
Most musicians at a certain point will sit down and they'll say, is our time coming? I mean, when you fly 200 and 300 airplanes a year, you always feel that there's a point when it may catch up with you.
It is shortly before 6 o'clock Central Daylight Time. The pilot, Walter McCreary of Dallas, Texas, radios Houston Air Traffic Control. He's low on fuel and can't make Baton Rouge, 80 miles away. Instead, he'll try for a small airport at nearby Macomb, Mississippi.
We found out 10 minutes from the Baton Rouge airport that we ran out of gas, and I just heard the pilot go, oh, my God.
Pilot McCreary turns his plane to the left and starts back toward Macomb. His altimeter reads 2,000 feet. The time is just past 6 o'clock. One of the engines on the Convair quits, probably starved for fuel.
My wife and I were out sitting in our backyard,
and we heard this plane come over. It sounded like it was running on one engine. And then all of a sudden, I heard that engine go out.
By now, Pilot McCreary is desperately looking for a spot for an emergency landing. He follows a pipeline route. For reasons unknown, McCreary changes his mind and heads for a better spot, a pasture off to his left. The Convair 240 is in a glide 100 yards short of the pasture. The wings are clipping treetops. The plane stalls and goes down. The Lynyrd Skynyrd Band was riding high. They had just released a new album, Street Survivors, and set out on a 5-month cross-country tour to promote it. They were on their way to a concert at Louisiana State University when disaster happened.
We got this spiral down. It's trying to lose altitude, find a place to land. And I thought he was going to make this field, and at the last minute, I decided it wasn't. Started clipping pine trees. And at that point, I grabbed a blanket and braced myself. Just blanket over my face.
All I saw was treetops. I looked out my windows in the middle of the airplane on the right wing. I tried to get close to the back of the airplane as possible. But I got in the middle of the airplane on the right wing, and all I saw was treetops. And at first it wasn't so bad, but then when I hit the middle of the trees, it was horrible. Yeah, it's an experience nobody wants to ever experience, ever.
Pianist Billy Powell, drummer Artemis Pyle, and another passenger managed to climb through a window and go for help. Neighbors who'd heard the crash were among the first rescue workers to arrive.
We walked through the woods to the site. And at that time, there was nobody on the site. Well, we started getting them out then, getting the ones that were hurt out, everybody's out too.
Under the glare of helicopter floodlights, the 23 victims were pulled one by one from the wreckage, placed on stretchers, and carried 100 yards through dense woods and across a creek to waiting ambulances. They were rushed to Southwest Mississippi Medical Center in Macomb. Hospital. Six are dead. 11 are admitted for treatment after receiving emergency care. 8 are flown to 2 other hospitals in Jackson, Mississippi. 1, drummer Pyle, was treated and released. By all accounts, the hospital staff handled the disaster well. The head doctor credited countless rehearsals, which he said prepared his people for the real thing. Before dawn the next morning, the hospital had compiled a list of 26 names and notified next of kin. The dead, the pilot and co-pilot. Band leader Ronnie Van Zant. Guitarist Steve Gaines. His sister, singer Cassie Gaines. And assistant road manager Dean Kilpatrick of Jacksonville. The 20 survivors included singer Leslie Hawkins, bass guitarist Leon Wilkerson, guitarist Alan Collins, and guitarist Gary Rossington. Wilkerson and Rossington suffered the most severe injuries.
He has 2 broken arms, a broken leg, a broken pelvis, a punctured stomach, and a punctured liver. And he's going to be in the hospital in Jackson, Mississippi for about another month. But Leon's got tremendous amounts of internal injuries, and Alan's got a cracked neck.
Every airplane crash is methodically investigated by specialists from the National Transportation Safety Board. They look at wreckage as pieces of a puzzle, which when put together will tell them why a plane crashed. The search at the scene even extends to the passenger's luggage. The board looks into about 4,500 mishaps a year. To the field investigators, wreckage is routine business. But for the rest of us who saw the remains of Lynyrd Skynyrd's Convair 240, the sight is unforgettable. You can't even realize, seeing one of these things on television, exactly what a crash of this magnitude looks like. Up there, sitting against the tree, is a piece of an airplane wing, torn away from the rest of the airplane. Lying down there, at the base of the tree, is the engine. And that back there, that twisted metal back there, is the fuselage of the plane, which sort of was turned around a corner.
It was just terrible. People are hollering, screaming, and I've never witnessed anything before in my lifetime.
It was just a disaster to me. I've never seen anything like it. And it just hit me hard.
9 days have passed since the crash, and the investigation has really only just begun. A Authorities still believe the plane ran out of gas. But why? Didn't they put enough gas in the tanks? Or was there a leak? We won't know the answers to those questions for at least a month. Gary Rossington and Leon Wilkerson are still hospitalized in the intensive care unit. They could stay there anywhere from 2 more weeks to a month. Leslie Hawkins has had extensive plastic surgery on her face. Alan Collins is moving around despite a huge plaster cast for his cracked neck. Artemis Pyle is not in the hospital, but friends say he is still not recovered from the shock. What about Leonard Skinner? Will there be a Leonard Skinner after this? I don't think so.
I don't want to raise anything that's nightmarish. It has to be nightmarish for him. But you're in the plane, you know it's going down. Give us a sense of that. I mean, did you spend your time in prayer? Did you spend the time cursing the airplane?
Well, we were playing poker and just having a flight, you know, on a private plane. There's no rules. You don't have to buckle up or sit down the whole time or nothing. Anyway, we were just flying along. But the co-pilot came back and said, hey, guys, we got trouble. We're going to make an emergency landing in a field, so get ready. Put your head between your legs and buckle up. So most people did that, you know. Now, myself, Ronnie was by me, and Dean, another guy that died during the crash, our road manager, Dean Kirkpatrick, and Alan was across from me, and Cassie and Steve Gaines, they both died. And me and Alan didn't, so we always ask ourselves, why didn't we go and not them? But the sense before it crashed was, you're in so much shock or disbelief, and at the same time, belief, and oh my God, it's true. And what, you don't have time to think, even if you had 10 minutes, your mind just goes. And I thought, I just, you know, was waiting and thinking, nothing. You know, I didn't know what to think. But it was really scary for a minute. And then all of a sudden it was a real calm, like, well, it's gonna happen. And then it started and we hit the tops of trees. And it was real loud and started soft. It got so loud until it just crashed, you know. And I woke up, it was like a Vietnam experience or something. I wasn't there, but I woke up in a swamp hearing all my brothers crying or screaming, you know, because they were hurt and it was natural or dead. And so I was laying, I was hurt real bad, and I thought the plane door was on me, some hunk of metal. And I screamed out for somebody to get it off of me. And finally I said, Dean, our roadmaster, get this thing off of me. And, well, Dean walked over and threw that piece of metal off of me. But then later in the hospital, a few weeks later, a doctor told me that the way he came in, he couldn't have done that. What happened to him? So it was his spirit. So I believe in that. But there was so much I could go on for 2 days about.
He was a helper, wasn't he?
It was God. You see him. And after the crash, I remember laying in the hospital for the first week or so. But the first 3 or 4 days, I say three because that's when Jesus, you know, was resurrected after 3 days. But I could see all of their faces and the flowers. People were sending a lot of flowers. They were all over the room. And when I looked in there, I'd see them. And I believe it was their spirit helped me get through it. But coming to me and being there right with me, I remember that. But going down, that sense of going down, to me, it was more peaceful than crazy.
The engine started sputtering, the right engine and the left engine, or the left engine and the right engine, or whatever. And what was happening was the plane was running out of gas. The pilots found out they screwed up and ran out of gas. And as the engine started sputtering, when the first one started sputtering, I jumped up and ran to the cockpit. And I wanted to figure out what the world was going on, and knowing that this was fixing to be a disaster in my mind, because I know what 60,000 pounds of weight will do for you, you know. And none of those people on that plane had been in the military, or none of them were in construction, or none of them knew anything about weight and the factors of that. And they were musicians and crew, wannabe musicians, and people like that. That was just music people. They knew nothing about what they were just fixing to get into. I knew what we were in for in my mind, and I was mad as hell. Them pilots were putting us in a situation, putting me in it. At 645.49 seconds in 5.5 Victor Mike, we're at 4.5. We had descended from 6,000 feet in that couple of minutes to 4,500 feet, coming in at a 50-degree angle. And I heard somebody say, trees, and that was the first top of the trees that the plane hit, and I turned to head back to my seat, and I told them right there on that runway, I says, you know, that's not gonna make any sense to have an engine problem and fly with it. And they said, well, if the engine just quit running, we have one engine to run on. We can, it's no problem. And they chose to go through the woods or to hide in the woods, one guy did, and not come back, try to help the people that were injured or dead. There again, it was getting dark, and but I can't see why you didn't want to come back. This one fella, I ain't gonna mention his name, I called him years later and asked him, why didn't you help somebody? You didn't get hurt, you didn't get a scratch on you, yet you went out in the bushes and squatted down and hid and looked and watched for an hour, for 45 minutes, for 2 hours. And you come back and try to help those people. Ronnie Van Zandt had an eighth inch nick and a fractured leg in his, a bone in his leg. His own father, when he went to identify the body the next day, October 21st, said also that Ronnie looked like he was asleep. No injuries. He said they just had a little bump right here behind his head, a little cut. And Lacey didn't know his leg was broke. He says he just looked like he was laying there asleep. And this massive ball of fire flew out that engine, and the plane was coming up, and I got out of my seat, and I pulled myself up to the cockpit and was holding on to the back of the pilot's seats. Told them to set the plane, turn the plane around because had an engine blowed up or had a ball of fire blow out or something. They said nothing's wrong. So now, seats, seat belts, briefcases, hand carry bags, junk was piled in here. And on the bottom of this pile was Steve, Dean Kilpatrick, Ronnie Van Zandt on the bottom of this massive bunch of bodies. So they took me out to the cemetery. And I said, where are we going? They said, well, you're going to visit Ronnie. Ronnie didn't make it. And that's the first I knew right then that Ronnie didn't make it. I didn't know it for the whole month. Nobody told me. I guess they said your condition was so bad that they didn't want to try to set you back any. And sad situation. And I was, I was panicky, freaking out. I was just pissed off about being in that situation. Being in a tub, 60,000 pound tub, is going to hit the ground. I'm still mad about it. It still pisses me off. For a while, it was a big shock. I mean, I was real upset that he didn't make it. Still am upset he didn't make it, you know, and really I kind of like, probably deep down inside, I blame myself a whole lot.
Sharon Lawrence said it would not be fair for anyone to try to replace Ronnie Van Zandt. At the hospital last Friday morning, Ronnie's father was asked if he was proud of his son.
Was I? Indeed. I knew that he was going to make it.
10 days ago, I knew Lynyrd Skynyrd only by their music. Now I feel kind of like I know them personally, not just as celebrities, but simply as people. Yeah, they experienced the elation and also the drudgery of being rock stars, and certainly rehearsing out here in this field, they must have done some sweating as well. Now those who are surviving are also experiencing the pain, not just of their injuries, but also the pain of losing their leader and two other friends. Ronnie Van Zandt was more than the lead singer of that band. He was the father of the group. Some people in Jacksonville will remember Ronnie differently. They will think of him as the sweet-faced young boy who delivered the newspaper. Ronnie himself, I think, by what his friends say, doubted whether Jacksonville respected him. He said once, "I'm Shantytown. They'll never care about me here." Of course, those who knew him respected him and loved him. Now I'd like to say a word about those young people who are still lying in the hospitals in Mississippi. They're thinking of Jacksonville, of home, and of their friends. The words of the song are, "Lord, I'm tired and I want to go home.
I need all my friends to talk to. Gary Rossington said, tell everybody hello and love and don't worry about me. Leon Wilkerson, who can only write notes, gave a message to a friend that said, I feel this was a lesson, another step toward a different world that'll be much better.
Do. Well, I think he'd be real proud. He loved baseball and he loved children. He loved living in Clay County. This is where our daughter was born. This is where he lived when he died. We lived on Brickyard Road. I think he'd be very proud that people would remember him after such a long time. I'm not really sure, but it's something that I've just begun to realize recently, that so many people are influenced and still listen to Skinner and still love Ronnie. It amazes me. I read an article in the Jacksonville paper probably a month or so ago where Billy Ray Cyrus said that Skinner, that was the only band he used to listen to, was Leonard Skinner. Kind of amazed me. I was watching ESPN and I saw Will Clark from the San Francisco Giants, and they asked him, you know, what kind of music do you listen to? He said, well, I listen to Southern Rock. Leonard Skinner is one of my favorite bands. And, you know, it's like, I never realized this. And you know that a lot of bands are influenced by it, but you don't realize that all these other people, you know. And I've had people come up to me and say that, you know, Leonard Skinner helped me get through college, or they saved my life, things like that. So it's pretty amazing.
And you were actually there.
Yes. Fortunately and unfortunately. Unfortunately because of the injuries I received, but in a way fortunately because the Leonard Skinner Band, I don't see the new group terribly often, so and I don't mean this to disparage them, but the Leonard Skinner group that I knew in 1977, well, they were the salt of the earth. They were some of the best people I've ever met. And despite the plane crash, I am pleased to have been associated with them in any way. Great people.
Why don't we move forward in time? Let's go to the day of the takeoff. Let's go. You're on the tarmac.
Yes.
And there's apparently some trouble with the engine. Actually, let's back up. The fuel gauge apparently didn't work. Is that right?
As I understand it, yes. The fuel gauge in the airplane was inoperative, and the way the pilots knew how much fuel was on board the plane was they would stick a stick down the wings and see how wet it got.
I had a 74 Dart. I used to do that same thing.
Well, this was, speaking of 74, this was, I hear, a 47, if memory serves. In December of 1947, Convair 240.
It was originally a passenger airliner?
Yes, it was. Uh-huh. And had been converted kind of into a cruise.
And it was a propeller prop plane?
Yes.
Twin engine
prop plane. About the size of a DC-3 or maybe, well, not everyone knows the airplanes. Imagine a Greyhound bus with wings.
Right.
You know, the fuselage was around the size of a bus.
So according to the wood stick in the tank, and somebody probably took a record of how much gas was being pumped into the plane.
Yes.
So according to the wood stick and that, they had some reasonable idea of how much fuel was in it, and it should have made the trip.
Yes.
So you show up at the airport, there's your plane.
Yes.
Anything unusual getting on the plane?
Sort of. Not so much getting on, but once we were on board, we were sitting there in our seats, and the airplane was sealed, as must be, but the ventilation or the air conditioning system doesn't work when it's on the ground.
Right.
And October 20th in South Carolina.
Getting kind of hot in the plane.
Getting hot. And we were all a little uncomfortable. And, of course, there was no smoking while they were getting the fuel mixture ready for takeoff and, you know, fueling the plane and the like. And all of us nicotine addicts and those who weren't, who were, you know, just dying of the heat, we were uncomfortable. And as I understand it, I don't recall how long it was, but I have been told it took us 45 minutes to get the fuel mixture right before the planes would take off.
And where were you on the plane?
At the very front, you know, the cockpit.
Right.
You know, behind that were the doors that we'd enter the plane.
And there's some bench seats there, couches?
Sort of, yeah. Well, when you first walk on the plane, there's kind of there's a lavatory in the galley bar area, whatever. And then you walk in kind of a living room area with your a curved
That's where you were?
Along one of the fuselage. No, I was not. I was not in the front part there. But just behind that, where rows of regular airplane seats started, I was in the first row of airplane seats. Nobody was that I remember. No one was on the window seat. I was in the aisle seat, the front left side of the plane. And this is part of this is what I remember, and just snippets of pictures in my head. And part of it is judging by the chart that Alan Collins drew out for me in the hospital following the crash as to where who was seated. And neither of us remembered anybody next to me, but there was me in and across the aisle.
10 minutes from Baton Rouge, everything took a nosedive. Gene Odom was one of 26 people on that plane.
The engine would start spinning, you know, and then the other one would start spinning. And then they would suck up some fuel. And when it sucked up the fuel, it would draw air. And spin the damn planes that way. And you know, just what a damn nightmare that is at 10,000 feet.
Gene, head of security for the band, couldn't keep anyone safe now. He and others on that fateful flight, including lighting engineer Mark Howard, knew the plane had problems.
2 days before in Lakeland, Florida, when we left the show, after we loaded out, we got on the plane, we took off, and the right engine shot a 6-foot flame out of the back of it.
Brody Mark Frank didn't want to get back on that plane either, and he wasn't alone.
People had brought up and were uncomfortable about it.
Their tour manager insisted on fixing the plane in Baton Rouge.
We're like, well, why can't the mechanic fly here and fix it while we got a day off instead of us going there, you know, and him fixing it there while, you know, it just didn't make sense. It didn't add up.
It would take a strong person going back to that very day to go, I'm not getting on it. Bye.
It's like, well, what are you going to do? You know, this is your job. The show must go on, right? So, you know, it's like, you want to fly home or you want to fly with us?
I put myself on that plane that day. If I didn't want, I could have gone home, I could, whatever. Nobody had a pistol to my head. I got on it from my own free will. So I own that decision. But everybody, you know, if I could take that day back, I would, you know. But it was almost like this whole thing got started months ago. And it was big bucks. You know, you got a tour going on.
Just 3 days earlier, the band released its new album, Street Survivors. In those 72 hours, the album was already gold. Baton Rouge radio personality Scott Innes says Lynyrd Skynyrd was red hot.
To be at the pinnacle of a band's career, this was their fifth album. It was, and still is, the biggest album of all time for Lynyrd Skynyrd. They were at the height.
Lead singer and founder Ronnie Van Zant didn't want to cancel on LSU.
Ronnie knew that if they were to switch planes, it would mean canceling a few dates till they could get it fixed out. And he said, there's no way we're going to give up 10,000 Southern rock and roll fans in Baton Rouge.
The fourth member of the 70s Southern rock supergroup to pass away, singer Ronnie Van Zant, guitarist Stephen Gaines, and backup singer Cassie Gaines, having been killed in a 1977 plane crash. Collins had been paralyzed in a car crash 4 years ago, and although already personally devastated by the death of his wife, Kathy, from pregnancy complications in 1980, he had still turned up at gigs on the group's 1987 reunion tour, sitting by the side of the stage in his wheelchair and occasionally remarking, I can't believe I'm not up there playing with them. Right now, here's a quick look back at Collins and the group of which he was such an integral part.
God bless all these musicians. God bless America. You, if it wasn't for you, there wouldn't be none of us. So God bless you all.
Stopped and was hovering right straight back through here from that tree line, and in the very back is a quarter of a mile.
It was a lot wetter that night.
It was a lot wetter that night, and we had to cross a black water slough. And
didn't really know what to do. I mean, you know, never seen anything like that.
You were a big Leonard Skinner fan, huh?
Well, it's what I grew up on.
There was a shallower place. May have been there. That we were walking out on.
I remember the nose of it. I had some training in advanced trauma life support, and we got busy.
We didn't know who it was. Didn't have a clue. I was thinking to myself, what is a bunch of hippies doing on an airplane? They don't look like they can afford a ticket.
I expected to see all dead people looking at these woods. I was amazed that there were that many survivors.
The fuselage was in a tree, which is no longer here. As we got the bodies on the stretchers, we walked over toward the creek. It wasn't a very long walk.
A lot of folks was just in a small, you know, accordion, mashed together and down in. You know, we would move a couple people. There's somebody else down there. They were moaning and saying, like, get me out of here, you know, like that.
As I was walking out, a friend of mine from Magnolia ran up to me and told me that the plane was Leonard Skinner's plane. And that just, I mean, I just was taken back by it. But he immediately then says, but don't worry, I think Leonard made it out.
And Van Zandt, well, you know, you already know all the details about who died, but nobody that was alive when we got there died. And I was proud of that. I was amazed that there were that many survivors.
All around the world, Leonard Skinner is known as quintessential Southern rock. Their hits stand the test of time and are still played today.
I love playing drums. I've played all my life. I love this music. And I'm going to play it as long as I can play it right.
Artemus Pyle joined Leonard Skinner in 1974 and played drums on numerous Skinner albums. And he still plays that music live in the Artemus Pyle Band, just like he did on Monday outside Nissan Stadium.
I would never call my band Leonard Skinner. Without Ronnie Van Zandt, there is no Leonard Skinner.
Today, he's playing in Chicago, honoring Ronnie Van Zandt and those lost 40 years ago in 1977.
Everything was great. We were on top of the world. We had an airplane with our name on it.
But that airplane, carrying Leonard Skinner from South Carolina to Louisiana, never made it to its destination.
Then we ran out of fuel over Mississippi and spiraled in.
The plane crashed, killing six, including members of the band.
Ronnie was killed. Steve Gaines was killed. Cassie Gaines, she sat directly in front of me.
But Artemus survived and amidst the chaos was able to run to a nearby farmhouse to seek help. That's when he found a man.
He was just protecting his family. That's all.
He had a gun and told Artemus, who was covered in blood, to stop.
I was stumbling and I moved forward and he fired and caught me in the shoulder and it spun me around. I yelled plane crash with what I thought was my last breath.
Luckily, Artemus wasn't injured too badly and the man helped him, but there was no saving the six who died that day. The band stopped playing together until 1987 when Ronnie's brother took the lead. But Ronnie, Steve, Cassie, and the others lost continued to live on through the music.
I'm so proud of Ronnie, and I know that Ronnie would be proud to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. He would be proud to be in Forrest Gump, Sweet Home Alabama, and Freebird and Forrest Gump. That's pretty cool.
In Nashville, Jesse Knudsen.
We keep that legacy alive by playing the music with honor.
Piano player for Leonard Skinner, Billy Powell, died earlier today, January 28th, at his house of an apparent heart attack. It came just a half day before he was scheduled to undergo a checkup and tests on his heart. He called 911 at about 1 a.m. this morning, complaining of problems breathing. When help arrived, he had already passed on. Skinner is postponing dates, and arrangements are being made for one of rock and roll's great. greatest piano players. In an earlier interview, vocalist Johnny Van Zant and guitarist Ricky Medlock talked about one of the most surreal moments playing an early morning show on Fox News at the expense of Powell.
We're playing acoustically. The camera's on Johnny and Gary interviewing them. And here's Billy Powell wandering around outside looking for us and finally seeing that we were doing an interview. And he's outside the window across the street.
We kept his ass out, man.
And everybody thought, now, we didn't allow Billy to come in. Bullshit, come on. I mean, and he just kind of wandered into the scene. And it was just kind of a surreal thing that, like,
while we were playing the song.
You know, that's Billy. You know, so, folks, we did not exclude him from the deal. And people are already on our website just thinking we counted him out or something, man.
Van Zant added,
what happened there, just to set the record straight, too, they only had so many channels, so they didn't have enough channels for keyboards and drums and all that stuff. You know, when you do these kind of morning shows, you know, they're kind of put together, I don't want to say haphazardly. Yeah, haphazardly, yeah. You know, so it was just a few of us that could go down and do it, so... It's the music business, folks. Don't take it so serious.
We are celebrating a rock and roll legend. Lynyrd Skynyrd, founding guitarist Gary Rossington, has passed away, but his legendary music, it lives on. Overnight, the music world celebrating the life of Lynyrd Skynyrd guitarist and co-founder Gary Rossington. Jacksonville, Florida native, founded the iconic Southern rock band in high school with his friends Ronnie Van Zant and Bob Burns. Rossington helping churn out hit songs for the band, including one of their biggest hits, Sweet Home Alabama.